Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Preeti Sharma, MBBS MD. I'm a product of Vardhaman Mahavir Medical College and Safdarjung Hospital. In this video series, what we will be dealing with is general microbiology. Certainly, a lot of cramming up is required in this, but what you need to understand, and here we are talking about both category of students, that is the one category of students who are preparing for their entrance exams. So remember, there will be 3 to 4 questions minimum from general microbiology when you appear for your entrance exam, be it a central institute exam or be it NEET PG. On the other hand, the second category of students who are aiming for their professional examination, for them also a couple of short notes, at least one or two, and long questions from this topic are important. So we will be focusing on both these category of students. And what are the topics that we will cover under general microbiology? So I've made a brief list for you over here. What we'll be starting with is the historical aspect. Yes, some people might find it very boring, but at the end of the day, you have to learn a lot of scientists because they've contributed immensely to this subject. After that comes something that is not only going to help you in microbiology, but also in pathology, and that is microscopy. So how does a microscope look like? What are its parts? What are the various types of microscopies? All of these are important. Next, once you've dealt with microscopy, what do you see under a microscope is a slide. So you need to know about staining. That is very important. So what are the different stains? Again, this is something that overlaps between microbiology and pathology. So you will be dealing that overlapping thing as well over here. Now let's go on to the main core microbiology. So yes, you need to know about bacterial anatomy, which fetches you a lot of questions because you need to know about the cell wall, the different layers of the bacteria, the structure, gram-positive, gram-negative. So very important topic. Once you know how a bacteria looks like, how does it grow? And I'll double star this because a growth curve is one of the most important questions that you deal with when you deal with general microbiology. Moving ahead, what is core microbio is culture. Again, culture is something that you will deal with every individual chapter as you go into systemic microbio, bacteriology, virology, and so on. But we need to make a summary of the different culture media that are present and what are the various methods by which this can be done. Finally, what is very important in every setup and day-to-day practice is sterilization and disinfection, not only for your own personal hygiene, but also very important for the patients. And in the end, in the era of genetics, we cannot ignore even the bacterial genetics. So we need to discuss the various forms by which genes get transferred, genes get mutated. So this is bacterial genetics. In the end, we will touch upon a topic called immunity. Yes, immunity is something that you must have studied in pathology in great detail. But what are those topics that form a part of core microbiology? We are going to go on with those topics, like all of you know, ELISA and so on. So in the same order, we are going to discuss general microbiology. And the first topic that we will start with will be the history. So let's begin with the historical aspect. And now, warning you, this historical aspect is going to have a lot of scientists. So remember, the first one that you need to know, and the most important, the first scientist is Sir Louis Pasteur. Now, yes, everyone says that remembering scientists is a little difficult, so I've got a couple of mnemonics over here for you. Just focus on the name of Sir, that is Sir Louis Pasteur. So focus on Pasteur. So obviously the first thing that he gave us was pasteurization of milk. Pasteurization of milk, which I'm sure everyone is aware of. In fact, he has contributed so much to the subject and to the field of medicine that we also have an institute made after his name. That is the Pasteur Institute, which is in Paris. So by Pasteur, you can easily remember these two things. Now, what are you left with when you talk about Lewis? So take the L from the Lewis and remember, he gave us the liquid media. He gave us the liquid media. So when we come to media, we will discuss how it started off from liquid to solid and to agar that we use now. So the first person who started this concept of media was Louis Pasteur. So L for Louis and L for liquid media. Now remember that he is so important that he is now referred to as the father of microbiology. Very important. Now, the remaining contributions you can remember just by this. If you focus on, he's the father, so he also gave us the fermentation principle. Focus on the next three alphabets, A, T, and H. So, students, remember, AT for autoclave, so he gave us the autoclave. And the H that you have over here, he gave us the hot air oven. So simple, F for father, F for fermentation, AT, the next two alphabets, he gave us autoclave, H, he gave us the hot air oven. And next, take the last four words. Theory. He gave us certain theories, and the most important thing that he gave us, I'm going to take this particular mnemonic from here, and I want you to know that he gave us the germ theory. Very, very important question that the examiner will put up to you a number of times, that which theory was given by Louis Pasteur, and it was germ theory. So he gave you one theory and he also disregarded one theory. So he said, or he abandoned, he said that there is nothing known as an abiogenesis theory. So he disapproved, the abiogenesis theory. Right? So he gave you one theory, that is the germ theory, and he disapproved one theory, that is the abiogenesis theory. Now we are still not completed. We haven't completed with him because he is the father, so he's given us a lot of things. He gave us three vaccines, and that is a very important question. Which are the three vaccines that Louis Pasteur gave us? And for that, you need to remember this mnemonic, that is CAR. So he gave us, number one, the cholera vaccine. Number two, he gave us the anthrax vaccine. And number three, which fetches the maximum number of questions, is that he gave us the rabies vaccine. Now, in the recent AIIMS exam, not only was it asked which vaccines were given by Louis Pasteur, but it was also asked that when he discovered this first rabies vaccine, who was the first boy to whom this vaccine was administered? So now that is also equally important. So remember, the first person or the boy to whom it was administered was Joseph Mister. So Joseph Mister received the first rabies vaccine. So now this is a summary of everything that Louis Pasteur has contributed to. So a quick recap. How are you going to remember it? By the term Pasteur, you will remember he gave you pasteurization of milk, and after him the Pasteur Institute in Paris is named. From the letter L, you will remember that he gave us which type of media? He gave us the liquid media. Okay, he is the father of microbiology. Most important thing, if you have to take it as your take-home message, is this. From this, you know F for father, F for fermentation, AT for autoclave, H for the hot air oven. Which two theories are we talking about here? Number one, he gave you the germ theory. Number two, he disapproved the abiogenesis theory. And finally, students, he gave you three vaccines, cholera, anthrax, rabies. Car mnemonic, and rabies was first administered to Joseph Meister. Every line and every word of Louis Pasteur is a one-line MCQ-based question. Also, contributions of Louis Pasteur is a very important short note that you can get in your university exams. Having dealt with him, now we move on to the next scientist that you need to know. And he is no less important, students. He is also a father that we have. The second one whom we are going to talk about is Sir Robert Koch. Sir Robert Koch. Now, what is important about him? Again, I'm going to help you with mnemonics. So, focus on the word Koch. So, obviously, number one, he gave us something known as the Koch's postulates. So, he gave us the Koch's postulates, number one. Number two, he gave us a bacilli, which is known as the Koch's bacilli. And I hope all of you can recall that this is actually the tubercle bacillus, right? Okay, moving ahead, again, focus on the name itself. If you focus on the letter C, he gave you a number of things with C. That is, first, he gave you the cholera bacilli. He gave you the cholera bacilli. Number two, he gave you, again with C, he gave you a culture media. And remember, liquid culture media was given by Alpha Liquid, Alpha Lewis. So Koch has now given us the solid culture media. So that is why I emphasized on liquid so much when we were doing Louis Pasteur. Koch gave us the solid culture media. Moving ahead, another thing with C, something to do with color. So remember, he gave us the aniline dye. So we will talk about aniline dyes, and you will study a lot of this when you do systemic microbiology. So he told you about the aniline dyes. So Koch for Koch postulates, for the Koch bacilli, that is TB. C for cholera, C for the culture media, that is solid culture media. And C for color, that is the aniline dye. That is what he gave you. Further, what you need to know, students, he is known as, now please remember this, he is known as the father of modern microbiology. So please do not confuse. When you talk about father of microbiology, it is Louis Pasteur. When you talk about father of modern microbiology, in that case, we are talking about Robert Koch. So as you can see, he has given us a lot of recent things that you deal with. So students, we just spoke about Robert Koch, and before I proceed on to something very important that he gave us, that is the Koch postulates, there is an additional thing that I want to add on to this, which you will read repeatedly as a question when you come to systemic microbiology. And that is, when you're talking about Koch, remember, there is the end with H. So he also gave us something known as the hanging drop motility. He also gave us the hanging drop motility, a very commonly done procedure to know the motility, that is hanging drop motility. So if you know all of these, and with a take-home message that father of microbiology is Louis Pasteur and father of modern microbiology is Robert Koch, what we now need to focus on, students, is something that I've written over here, that is Koch postulates. Right? So now, remember, when we're talking about Koch postulates, I'll just give you a story which will help you in remembering them. So the story is that, for example, this is a person and he gets infected with a disease. So this is an organism that has entered into this particular person. Now what you need to know is, obviously, he'll get infected. So that is the first postulate that you have. First postulate says that, number one, there should be a constant association. There should be a constant association between the organism and the person. Simple example that you need to know. Mycobacterium tuberculosis causes tuberculosis. Mycobacterium tuberculosis does not go and cause malaria or measles or leprae. It causes TB. So MTB will cause TB. That is a constant association. There is nothing else. When MTB's mood changes, it will not start causing anything else. So that is a constant association. That's Koch postulate number one. What is Koch postulate number two? Okay, so now this person was infected with this disease. What did I do for the diagnosis? I took a blood sample or I took a culture sample and I tried to put it on a media. So if this is a culture plate. So remember, the second Koch postulate says that I should be able to isolate that organism in a pure culture medium. So postulate number two is isolation in pure culture medium. Isolation in pure culture medium. That's not enough. Now I've isolated. What am I going to do next? Now I'm going to take this culture and I'm going to put it in an experimental model. So let's say, like all of us know, we use mice as experimental models. So the third Koch postulate is that we should be able to inoculate. Inoculation into experimental models should produce the same disease. The disease that occurred in humans, the same disease should occur in this experimental model when I put that organism from the culture plate into that organism. So should produce the same disease. Still not over. Now when this animal is suffering from this disease, I should be able to take a sample from this animal and again I should be able to extract it on a culture medium. So that was isolation from the humans. This is re-isolation from the organism. So number four is re-isolation. Re-isolation in culture from the animal. So now with this story, I hope everyone can understand the four Koch postulates. Number one, the infection entered the body of the person and this infection must have a constant association. That is keyword number one. I tried to put it up on a culture medium and I could isolate. So isolation is number two. I take the medium, I put it in an experimental animal. So I'm inoculating. That is point number three. I take it from the animal and I again put it on a culture and I can again re-isolate it. So point number four. And then came a modification and now we also have point number five, which I'm going to write down over here only because this is a newer one. And it says, if I consider this to be the organism, means this is the antigen. So whenever an antigen enters the human body, it should be able to produce antibodies. So that is the fifth postulate, that antigen should be able to cause antibody production in the humans. So this entire summary becomes the five main Koch postulates. Now what happened is that these Koch postulates got a little modified, not too much. But till now we were talking about the antigen, or basically we were talking about the organism. Then a modification occurred in this and now there is something known as the modified Koch postulate. And nothing, the same principles say, but the difference is that rather than saying that the organism is causing this, it is now said by the modification that it should be the gene which should abide by all these things rather than organism, rather than microorganism, rather than microorganism. So simple, the Koch postulates was that all of these five things should happen. Modified Koch postulates also say that all of these five things should happen, but they say that don't blame everything on the microorganism. Rather than the microorganism, it should be the gene which should be able to abide by this. So this is the modified Koch postulates. Now when we are dealing with the Koch postulates, there is one more thing that you need to know. I'm going to change the term, and now it will become the Koch phenomenon. There is something known as the Koch phenomenon. And the Koch phenomenon is simple, which was, it was a phenomena that Koch identified. And what he identified was that if there was a guinea pig, who had suffered from tuberculosis, so he had tuberculosis and that went on. When Koch tried to inject a tuberculosis, what happened was that the guinea pig suffered from a hypersensitivity reaction. And this entire phenomena is referred to as the Koch phenomena. So just changed postulates for phenomena, and this is what you have. So remember three things with Koch. One, you need to remember the five Koch postulates. Point number two, you need to know that the Koch postulates have been modified. So we have modified Koch postulate. And point number three is that there is something known as a Koch phenomena. So the two main fathers of microbiology are done, that is Louis Pasteur and Robert Koch. Now we need to go on to an entire list of other scientists who've contributed immensely to this subject. Okay, so the third one that we are going to start with is Sir Paul Ehrlich. Again, I'm going to try and simplify the scientists as much as possible for you. So Sir Paul Ehrlich, first of all, he has it in his name. So the organism or the disease that he described was Ehrlichia. Point number one, that is simple. Point number two is, if you focus on the last two alphabets, CH, that stands for chemotherapy. Sir is known as the father of chemotherapy. Father of microbiology, Louis Pasteur. Father of modern microbiology, Robert Koch. Father of chemotherapy, Sir Paul Ehrlich. Now what you need to know is that he also gave the concept of acid fast stain. Very, very important stain when you will study it later on. Gets a lot of questions. Acid fast staining. He gave you this acid fast staining. So when we discuss acid fast staining, the first question that I will revise with you will be the scientist. Also, the last contribution that we need to know, he standardized the toxin and antitoxin. So there is a test that is toxin, antitoxin, and he did standardization of this. So these are the four take-home messages for Sir Paul Ehrlich. That is, he gave us the Ehrlichia, he's the father of chemotherapy, he gave us acid fast staining, and he also standardized toxin, antitoxin. After this, we go on to the fourth scientist, who is Sir Joseph Lister. Again, I'm going to help you with the mnemonic over here. If you focus, Sir Joseph Lister has SEP, so that is to do with sepsis. Sir Joseph Lister is known as the father of antiseptic surgery. Now, Sir Joseph Lister actually used carbolic acid first time in the surgical OT as an antiseptic solution. And there onwards, the concept of antisepsis, sterilization, disinfection, and so on and so forth came up. So remember, Joseph, he has it in his name, so probably it was pre-decided that he was born to do this. Joseph Lister is known as the father of antiseptic surgery. Moving ahead, now we have to go on to a scientist who everyone is aware of. The scientist who discovered our light microscopes and made our lives so much easier. So, the fifth scientist whom we have, and I hope everyone already knows this, Antony von Leeuwenhoek. Antony von Leeuwenhoek, he gave us the light microscope. He gave us the light microscope. And that is why he is also known as the father of microscopy. So it is from him that everything started. He is the father of microscopy. And the first organisms that he saw under the microscope, he called them, and again, that is also a question, he called them little animalcules. He called them little animalcules. So Antony von Leeuwenhoek, sir, has made our life simple. He has given us the light microscope. That is why he is the father of microscopy. And what he saw, he named them the animal or the little animalcules. Now this was age old and light microscopy has been coming on, but we've also made a lot of advancements and now we have electron microscopy. So E for electron and E for the scientist who gave electron microscopy. So scientist Ernst Ruska. Scientist Ernst Ruska. So E for Ernst and E for, he gave us the electron microscopy. He gave us the electron microscopy. Moving on to the seventh scientist, which is, I'm sure everyone is aware of, the scientist who gave us the first vaccine. So yes, we have Sir Edward Jenner. We have Sir Edward Jenner. And I hope everyone knows that he gave us the smallpox vaccine. He gave us the smallpox vaccine. So that was a good thing because he gave us the first vaccine. He derived it from a cowpox and he gave us the first vaccine that was smallpox vaccine.